I'm Kara Fettermeyer. I run the Cognition and Brain Lab here at the Beckman, and I'm in the Department of Psychology. And my lab, at a general level, studies how people comprehend the world. So how it is that if you read a word or hear a sentence or see a picture, that you can so rapidly connect that perceptual information to all the things you know and all the information that comes along with that. And the fact is, we do that incredibly rapidly and really quite effortlessly in most cases. And so we'd really like to understand how it is that the brain allows us to do that. One of the things that makes that challenging to do is that comprehension is inherently this internal state, right? So how do we measure comprehension if we want to study it scientifically? Luckily for us, we can do this by measuring electrical signals in the brain. The brain being fundamentally an electrical organ, the brain is always generating electrical signals. That's how neurons communicate with one another. And one of the nice things about electrical signals is that they create electrical fields. So you can simply put a little bit of conductive metal, something that is sensitive to electricity, which we call an electrode, and we simply place it on the head. So now this metal is in the brain's electrical field, and it's going to change along with the brain's electrical field. So for example, in my laboratory, we measure a particular electrical signal known as the N400. It's a negative voltage, and it peaks around 400 milliseconds. And what makes it really cool for understanding comprehension is that the size of this activity is directly related to how well people are comprehending. So when you give people a sentence that ends in a weird way, I take my coffee with cream and dog. Dog does not fit that sentence very well. It's hard to comprehend, and the N400 signal is quite large. If I say, I take my coffee with cream and sugar, the N400 is smaller. So by measuring this piece of electrical signal in the brain, we get an index of something directly related to a cognitive state. And there are other aspects of the electrical activity that might tell us about attention or memory retrieval or other aspects of cognition. So all the things that the brain are doing that we might be interested in terms of cognition, generate particular patterns that, if we're lucky, we can extract and use as a measurement. So one of the things we do at the annual Beckman Open House is to have a toy that is going to measure electrical signals of the brain and turn those into something that people can see. It uses some of the same technology we use in the lab. So it's really, we're just putting a headband on someone, and it has those metal electrodes on the headband. And then what this toy does is take those signals and kind of monitor them to look for a particular speed of change, an oscillation with a particular frequency that has been linked to paying attention well, to focusing your attention. And the more of that activity it picks up, it causes more power to be sent to a tiny little fan in the toy, and we have a little foam ball that's positioned over the fan. So if you are paying more attention, the fan blows harder and the ball levitates, which is kind of a cool thing. When you're sitting there with this ball on a fan and somebody's telling you it's your level of attention that's going to control the ball, we know we should be able to focus our attention, but how do we actually do that? So this ball is creating what's known as biofeedback. So it's creating a sort of externalization of these hidden internal physiological states. And so this is, for us, the really kind of a fun part of the exhibit, is watching people try to figure out how to focus their attention. People try different things. They try doing mental math, or they try reading something, or they focus on a song, or they just try to clear their mind and think about the ball. And different people find that different things work for them. At least for some people, they figure something out. They figure out, if I read or if I focus on the ball in this way, I can consistently now control it. And it isn't even necessarily always something they could explicitly describe, but they begin to be able to use the toy with more control. Once they get to the point where they see, oh, I can make the ball go up and down, then the challenge becomes, how well can you control how much you're paying attention? So it's really cool to see people begin to see that by having this externalized signal, they can try different things and get a little more control over their own internal brain states. And I think it leads to some interesting thoughts and questions about whether there are things more generally that we can do that will help us better be able to control some of these internal states that we know are important, but we don't necessarily know how to manipulate without having some of these devices.